So we got a couple of mics here. You're more than welcome to come on up and share your perspectives. Take 2 minutes or maybe even 3 minutes to present your thoughts, your point of view, and then ask a question.
I was actually happy that Elizabeth May put forward this resolution at in Parliament, asking for I'm blanking on the word now, but anyway, and she, it was against this resolution to condemn supporters of BDS and condemn the BDS movement. She was active in opposing that. So she came here. Dave Nickerts, who is here somewhere, ran in my riding for the provincial MLA seat, and Elizabeth May came to that riding to speak, and I wanted to congratulate her for putting this petition up on the board of the Parliament of Canada. And so I waited in line, and I thanked her as I had written. I had signed the petition, and I thanked her for that. And I said that I was a member of Independent Jewish Voices, and she said, "Oh, that's great. You know, I just have spoken to Haidar Abu Ghosh about about his presentation in Victoria. She had just seen it. And Haidar came because his village sits within Canada Park, which is something that was taken over by the Jewish National Fund. And she was enthusiastic. She said, "We are bringing forward this resolution about BDS to our convention this summer." And she seemed like she was in support of it. At least I thought that, and my partner, she was there and she heard it, so it wasn't just me imagining it. So I'm asking you, what happened? Like, was that the case that she changed her position, and what happened in the course of that?
That is probably the most asked question that I've had to respond to. Or variations of that have constantly been posed to me in these town halls. I think some of the history of this is instructive. It's not well known. There were, many of you will know that there were in fact two resolutions at the convention relating to human rights violations by the State of Israel. One was addressed to BDS and the other one was addressed to the charitable status of the Jewish National Fund. The resolution that was addressed to the charitable status of the Jewish National Fund was brought forward by Corey Levine. When she brought that forward, she asked Elizabeth to co-sponsor that resolution, and it explicitly identified the Jewish National Fund as a discriminatory organization that ought not to have charitable status in Canada. And Elizabeth May asked me to co-sponsor that resolution, and I did. And then I asked Elizabeth, she didn't know at the time, I said, "As it happens, I've just returned and I've seen some terrible things in the Palestinian territories. I'm bringing forward a resolution on BDS. Will you support that?" And she refused. Then, after the online vote, organizations like B'nai B'rith became aware of these two resolutions and began to attack our party quite terribly. Some horrible things have been said about me, which I don't care to repeat. And at that point, Elizabeth withdrew her support of the JNF resolution. She had never been a supporter of the BDS resolution, but she withdrew her support of the JNF resolution. And I've never heard any plausible, persuasive explanation for why she changed her position. What I do know is that she changed her position after the attacks began. Now, I want to be fair to Elizabeth. It's very difficult to be in that position, to be the leader of the party, and to be attacked in this way. So I have some sympathy. Believe me, I've probably had to deal with the worst of the attacks, and I have sympathy for people who have to deal with that kind of language, very hateful language. But nonetheless, we have to speak truth to the power. We have to stick by our moral principles, we have to stick by the values of our party. My loyalty is not to a leader, it is not to a logo, it is not to the green banner. My loyalty is to six values enshrined in the constitution of our party, and I will defend them come hell or high water. And I think it's our obligation as our leader to do so as well. Beyond that, I can't comment on why she won't support BDS, except to say that she has said repeatedly that she doesn't think it will work. In the convention, she didn't deny any of the human rights violations. Many of these violations I talked about today were particularized by myself and the other speakers. She didn't deny them. She admitted that these were the facts. All she has had to say in terms of justifying her opposition to BDS is that it won't work. I don't know whether it's going to work. I don't purport to know. It may work. It certainly helped in the case of South Africa, as Archbishop Desmond Tutu said. And one thing I do know for sure is that there is no better option. That's all we got. So I think it's incumbent upon us to support the only viable alternative left for the Palestinian people.
Hi there, my name is Yolanda. I am an Israeli, and needless to say, I disagree with your ways. I sat here and I listened to your presentation, and believe me, I have a lot of sympathy to the Palestinian people. But I did not like the fact that you presented only one side. Sitting here, I understood the Israelis are just shooting kids for fun or just doing things for the fun of thing, not to protect Israelis, which I think is wrong. I know that since the wall was built, the incidence of suicide bombing in Israel has been reduced. And what I want to say is that most Israelis, or many Israelis, would like the occupation to end, if you look at it as an occupation. The Arabs had a problem with Israel a lot before 1967, and since 1967, there are so many attempts to actually reach peace agreements, including in the Taba agreement and other places with Clinton, where even 96% of the land in the West Bank was going to be created a state in the Arab land in the West Bank, and it was rejected, not because of the land, but because of the law of return. So I don't know what is your solution to this problem. I really don't. Just to ignore completely the responsibility of the leadership of the Palestinian is really just burying your head in the ground. I'm sorry to tell you that. I don't think you can hold one party just because this party is stronger to say that if you're stronger, you're bad, and if you're weaker, you're good. That doesn't work this way. Sometimes you're weak, and your leaders are betraying you.
I myself think it's going to be a single state. I'm wondering what your thoughts are on that. I don't think there's ever going to be a Palestinian state.
I think there was an attempt, at least two attempts, to reach peace agreements with Palestinian leaders, and to establish a Palestinian state in the West Bank. As you know, Israelis left the Gaza Strip for one reason, to maybe give them self-determination, and instead of using the land that they had for peaceful and to grow their economy and to better the lives of the citizens of Gaza, the opposite has happened. It's very easy to ignore the rockets that are fired from Gaza into Israel on a regular basis. I want to see you living in Sderot with your baby and every day having rockets fired on you, and then when you do something about it, oh my God, the Israelis are murderers. I'm sorry, I can't see different ways to sort of just continue to exist.
I'd like to respond. First of all, I didn't say that Israelis are murderers. I did not interrupt you, ma'am. I'd like an opportunity to respond to you. Yes, the Israeli military has caused the deaths of hundreds of children, Palestinian children. The facts are very clear. I didn't, ma'am. Again, I didn't interrupt you, ma'am. There is actually you want to talk about human shields. There was an extensive investigation done by the Guardian. In connection with the 2009, and the Guardian is not by any means some, you know, anti-Israel newspaper. It did an extensive investigation and found that the Israeli soldiers had used, it found compelling evidence that they had used Palestinian children as human shields. Now you talk about you said that I said that because one side is stronger, therefore it's the evildoer. That's not what I said. I gave a whole litany of facts. All of those.
Do we have access to those investigations?
Finish. All of those facts inform my opinion. You talk about peace agreements. Have you looked at the map for the Oslo Accord? That was an unjust peace. It basically allowed the State of Israel to have control over the vast majority of the West Bank, and it created a series of Bantustans. Okay, and it did not impose any kind of a deadline, certainly one that's not been respected for an end to the occupation. It was a terrible agreement for the Palestinian people, and there is a serious dispute historically about what happened at Taba. You know, Noam Chomsky, a world-famous scholar, says that in fact the Israelis, there's historical record which he cites, that the Israeli negotiators did not go to Taba with any authority to do a deal.
Clinton felt otherwise.
Clinton is the furthest thing from an honest, neutral broker than one can find on the international stage when it comes to the rights of the Palestinian people.
How about Prince Bandar?
She has absolutely, Prince Bandar, the war criminal. No. I don't trust
him.
How is he a war criminal?
Yeah.
Well, in any event, the fact of the matter is. The fact of the matter is that there is a real dispute about what happened in this peace negotiation and whether there was a just peace. But I have a question for you, ma'am. How does any of these things that you've cited, the Hamas rockets, for example, you talked about that and that's often raised, how does that justify the settlements? Hamas is in control of Gaza. It's not in control of the West Bank. Why does Israel get to go steal Palestinian land in the West Bank because of rockets being fired from Gaza? There's absolutely no logical connection between the two. That is a clear violation of international law, and it must stop. And it will not stop until meaningful sanctions, peaceful in nature, are imposed upon the State of Israel for that violation.
Okay. You know, I agree with you. I agree with you that the settlements must stop. But at the same time, what's more important is the State of Israel should be acknowledged. Its security should be established and maintained. And the state of belligerency should cease. I mean, that was part of UN Resolution 242, that Israel, under the circumstances, would be prepared to relinquish not occupied territories as opposed to the occupied territories, under specific circumstances, that the state of belligerency and the securities of Israel would be secured. And at no time, I don't think that either party was prepared to make concessions for peace. In fact, I don't think the majority of the population in Palestine, the civilians of Palestine, are prepared to negotiate in a peaceful settlement. I think when you're brought up in kindergarten to be seen as a martyr and to be raised to murder civilians in Israel, then you have a major problem. When people are glorified for, you know, committing acts of atrocities by naming streets after them, that's a problem. And until that there's this incitement of hatred that is allowed to perpetuate, the hate will be maintained. And
on both sides.
Well, I think that there have been conciliatory efforts. I mean, if you look back to 1937, the Peel Commission, where Israel was prepared to partition, the UN resolution where Israel was prepared to accept the partition plan, the Arabs rejected it under the circumstances, and there was no counter-proposal. You go back to 1967. At that time, there's a Six-Day War, and following the Six-Day War, there was a meeting at Khartoum, and the Arabs responded with the three no's.
I was
no
here
peace,
before him, actually.
No
David.
Recognition.
If we're going to be point of order, I was here before he was.
No peace, no recognition, and there's a third one, which I can't recall, which you probably know. And then you go back to 2000, the Taba agreement, I thought was very reasonable. And it wasn't such that the land was non-contiguous. It was contiguous land. It was 97% of the West Bank that was being given up. As mentioned, Clinton felt there was a most failed deal. It was the most reasonable deal. You mentioned about the Prince Bandar of Saudi Arabia, who was a war criminal. I'd like to know how he's cited as a war criminal. It's not something that I'm feeling really.
Okay, if you could wrap this up, try to tie this up.
Okay.
For us.
The other thing is, I'm concerned about the double standard. I'd like to sort of go over what Thomas Friedman once said.
Quickly.
Thomas Friedman once said that when you criticism of Israel is fair game, but when you target Israel and you single out Israel at the expense of other countries that are far worse human rights violators, then that's anti-Semitism, and to call it otherwise is a liar, okay? I want to know how you feel under those circumstances, because I don't hear much of the criticism of other countries, like, for example, Russia, and how it engages in warfare this time as a means of not exercising disproportionate.
We don't send $38 billion to Russia. America and Canada.
I don't understand how that has any relevance.
We're going to let you come in here, Peter, in a second. Can you just wrap up, please?
Okay, I just wrapped up. I'm just understanding why the focus, why your focus is on Israel at the expense of other countries that are far worse human rights violators. Take a look at
that's
Freedom
a, that's
House.
A good
Take a look at Freedom House.
Okay,
Israel
you've asked the question.
Well,
it's a good
in terms
question.
Of human rights violations.
It's a good question. Thank
relative
you.
To other countries.
Why do we single out Israel?
I would go in even farther. Name me one country that performs better in terms of human rights, subscribing to human rights issues than the state of Israel that has to live under similar circumstances.
Thank you very much. We're going to see if we can answer that question. Why do we single out Israel?
Well, many of us who speak on these matters are actually involved in a wide range of issues. That's certainly true of me. I'm sure it's true of many people in this room. So to suggest that all of us here are interested only in Israel would probably be inaccurate in many cases. Secondly, to a very significant degree, people are going to choose to talk about things which interest them. Now, it might be that you focus on Israel because you're an anti-Semite. It might be that you focus on Israel because you're a Jew and feel a certain responsibility to speak out on these matters. It might be that you speak out about Israel because Israel is a very close ally of the Canadian government, and you think that the Canadian government might conceivably be able to influence things that happen in Israel to a degree which would not be so of many other nations. And it might also be the case that you focus on Israel because, as a matter of fact, you have a certain amount of respect for many aspects of Israeli institutions and life, and that you believe that many Israelis are reasonable people who wish to live decent lives with their neighbors, and that they can, in fact, be influenced in the same way that it turned out that the South Africans were influenced. So there are many reasons to focus on Israel.
Why don't you call for BDS sanctions against China?
Okay. I'm just going to jump in here with one sentence. Let me just present this, a one-liner. No, it's a very valuable question. I'm just going to give this one-liner from this article and then pass the microphone to Peter. This, again, is from an opinion piece in the Washington Post written by two Jewish academics, Stephen Levitsky and Glenn Weil, entitled, "We Are Lifelong Zionists. Here's Why We've Chosen to Boycott Israel." So the line says, "Israel, of course, is hardly the world's worst human rights violator. Doesn't boycotting Israel but not other rights-violating states constitute a double standard? It does. We love Israel, and we are deeply concerned for its survival. We do not feel equally invested in the fate of other nations." So one can criticize Israel, according to these folks, and actually be decidedly singling out Israel precisely because we love and admire Israel and are invested in its future.
I'm more concerned with psychiatric obsession.
But I don't think, thank you, David. I don't think there's an, oh.
Okay, quick.
I know, that's fine.
As I pointed out in my presentation, sir, before I brought this resolution forward, I was calling for an arms embargo on Saudi Arabia, and 2 years prior to that time, our party adopted a policy calling for an arms embargo on Saudi Arabia. Did you complain at that time that we were singling out Saudi Arabia?
I didn't hear much about it. I don't think that there's nearly as
well. I can tell you that this is not, sir. You said a lot, and I didn't interrupt you. There has been a very bright focus placed on Saudi Arabia human rights violations by many people in our party, including me, long before we ever had this whole issue arise about BDS, okay? So it's simply not true. But if you must know, I do feel a special responsibility, and I'm echoing something here that Mark Goldman said. I am a Canadian. My government gives unequivocal support to this state that is committing human rights violations.
Russia, we've imposed sanctions on Russia. Serious human rights violator. Iran, serious human rights violator. We impose sanctions on Russia, on Iran. You don't need to fill the void when it comes to those violators because there isn't one in our country. Our country is taking steps to deal with those violations, but we are protecting Israel. We have given it an exalted status, and we as Canadians have an obligation to put a stop to that. It's our government, it's being done in our name, and enough is enough.
Yeah, thank you, David. I just wanted to...
If we can just go one by one.
Sure, thanks, David. I do appreciate everyone's comments, because I first and foremost, it seems that it is a very sensitive issue around racism, and it's sort of not what we're about. And I just, to sort of maybe quickly address that, this isn't a meeting on human rights in Lebanon. We could have a meeting about that, or human rights in Syria, or human rights in China, but this meeting happens to be around the state of Israel versus Palestine, and I don't think we could open up the floor to talk about every human rights violator in the world at this meeting. And we have to do one step at a time. I think that would be how I would respond to that, because it's not, if you're dealing with women's rights, it doesn't mean that you're not interested in men's rights too. It's just, if you go to a meeting for women's rights, nobody's going to say you're a racist against men at that kind of a meeting. So that's how I just, the preamble there. Just the two things that I don't understand, and I'd like clarity from some people in the room and from yourself. I was trying to get a reinforcement. He talked about a double standard, and I'm not clear why the American government particularly, or the Canadian government, don't support financially, because there is no state in Palestine. Is that to make it clear why there's no money, $38 billion sent to Palestine? Is it? I'm just trying to get some clarity there.
Small sums of money going to Palestine.
$38 billion?
European Union, United States, but much smaller than what's going to Israel.
No Abrams tanks. And oh, okay. And so the other thing is the economic separation is my first question, and I've never understood that. And the second thing that I've never understood, and I'd like some clarity on, is if people are, we're talking about human rights in Canada or in Israel, why is there the double standard, right? If our friends were saying, and we have a citizen who was saying, that in the state of Israel I could have equal rights, or a Palestinian could have equal rights, and there was no violent, like, then there we wouldn't be having this discussion, right? Like, you can't, because I'm from Brandon, nobody's going to say, I can't come and live in Winnipeg, or I can't come live in Ontario. I mean, I've never understood that as the state of Israel, why. Because, and leading to that, we've all been raised, and quite rightly so, about all the horrible things that have happened and all the imbalance that happened in Europe and all the deplorable things that happened. We have a huge museum here to remind us, fantastic reminders, that I just don't understand why the gap between when people are being oppressed and then being the oppressor. That one's just absolutely shocking to me, because, I mean, I'm from Ukrainian descent, and there were 6 million people died in Ukraine, and it doesn't really get much coverage in school. And not that anyone dying in any war is not is a good thing. But anyway, those are the things I'd like to say. So I just like to get clarity that why there's not support, and why people can't be equal citizens in the state of Israel. It's just, you can only be Jewish to live there. I don't understand that.
Okay, let's hold that question in store. Why can't people live as equal citizens within Israel? Good one.
Hi, so I'm a sometimes voter for the Green Party and sometimes a strategic voter, and I vote for other parties. But I just wanted to say how much I appreciate, Dimitri, your comments. And I also have been to Hebron and Bethlehem, and I've seen the same things that you've seen. And so thank you for your leadership on this. And I have to say how disappointed I was to hear about Elizabeth May's backtracking, or whatever you want to call it, on this. I thought that she had more gumption than what I fear is we're seeing. And I think that's it. I As a Christian, I know that you're atheist, but I will pray for your ongoing work on this.
And this next person, who's been waiting for a bit, go for it.
I too want to thank you. I just came back from 3.5 years of humanitarian work in Jordan, which is just across the river, and had some opportunities to visit Jerusalem, Hebron, Bethlehem. But in Jordan, there are many refugees from the Nakba, the catastrophes, the wars in Israel-Palestine, and they had sought shelter in Jordan, and some would very much like to return. Some to live, but many just to visit, and they are denied access even to visit their cousins and relatives, even briefly for a weekend, which is only an hour and a half drive away. And so my heart went out to them, and I pray for peace for that region. And now as I returned, I was very encouraged. I was encouraged to see that the Green Party of Canada was going to support BDS and tell our Canadian government and tell the governments around the world that we care about human rights and the rule of law. My friends, my Palestinian friends in Jordan, they said, in Jordan, it's against the law to speak against the government and its policy, meaning Jordanian, the monarchy, King Abdullah II. But you're from Canada. You have democracy there and freedom of speech. Why doesn't anyone from Canada speak out? We can't. We're forbidden by law. And I said, when I returned, I would try to also convey that story. And so I am delighted that my church, the Mennonite Church of Canada, has approved a document supporting BDS this summer. And to hear also that the Green Party is supporting this is very encouraging to me. And my Palestinian friends in Jordan are grateful. So I thank you for your courage to bring this forward.
Thank you very much.
I want to actually ask a question. It's sort of turned into a series of diatribes. I want to refer to one of the statistics that you showed. This is Dimitri, this is addressed to you. When you showed the rates of unemployment in the West Bank and Gaza, I believe the figure for the West Bank, I think it was 2015, was 38%. Was it 18%? Whatever it is. So, I mean, I actually want to talk about the effect of BDS and look at it from an economic point of view. If it were the case that the BDS movement is actually harming the Palestinians and increasing their unemployment by inevitably forcing Israeli companies to withdraw from the West Bank, do you still support it, though? In other words, you're willing to fight this battle on the backs of the Palestinians. Is that the case?
You know, you can watch the co-founder of the BDS movement, Omar Barghouti, respond to that. And he says that that is a very patriarchal sentiment, that that is a decision that they have made, 170 organizations, trade unions, including trade unions, human rights organizations, and the occupied territories in Israel, speaking on behalf of the Palestinian people, broad-based support, want us to bring forward BDS motions of this nature and to support BDS. And they said, you let us worry about that. This is what we want you to do, and it's not up to you to tell us what's in our interests. We're telling you this is what we need desperately.
Have there been any public opinion surveys taken of Palestinians?
Well, you know, all I know is 170 organizations across the Palestinian population have come forward and said, we want this.
So if I were to quote, by the way, Noam Chomsky is not in favor of BDS.
Actually, I think his position is more
nuanced. He qualified it.
It's more nuanced than that.
It's nuanced. Yeah. But, you know, I'm going to quote from a Palestinian criticizing, just briefly, BDS spokespeople,
justified calling for boycotts that will result in increased economic hardships for the Palestinians by asserting that Palestinians are willing to suffer such deprivations in order to achieve their freedom, which is exactly what you just quoted or paraphrased. It goes without saying that they themselves live in comfortable circumstances elsewhere in the world and will not suffer any such hardship. It would seem, in fact, that the BDS movement, in its determination to oppose Israel, is prepared to fight to the last drop of Palestinian blood. This is a Palestinian who says he lives in East Jerusalem and hopes to build a better life for his family. He says, for our own sake, we need to reconcile with our Israeli neighbors. Now, I'm not opposed. I think, you know, I don't want the people here to think that any of us, or I certainly don't support Israeli settlements. I find them heinous. The kind of sentiment there that was voiced by that, for that Israeli killer, is something that's totally anathema to most right-thinking Jews. I think Mark knows that I'm willing to give voice to criticisms of Israel. What I object to, though, and this is what I find very hard to take, and it's not the question of singling out. It's the effectiveness of this approach. When SodaStream closed its factory in Maale Adumim, throwing some 400 Palestinians out of work, what did you accomplish beyond a moral victory? And they relocated that factory to Beersheba. What good did it do? And when you close down factories and you cause economic dislocation, okay, for Barghouti, who's, you know, he's willing to fight the battle in the trade unions, it's just like, you know, the Palestinian Authority, who do they speak for? There's a question here of the actual effect on the individual Palestinians. Do you not feel anything for the people who are losing their jobs?
Of course I do. Of course I do. And I totally disagree with what, I don't know whom you're quoting, sir. I can tell you that I've spoken to dozens and dozens of Palestinians about this issue, both inside the occupied territories and in the diaspora, and they, every single one of them, support BDS. Not one of them has expressed the sentiments that you just expressed. And what that gentleman said, whoever it may be, that those who support BDS are living in comfort abroad, that's just not true. I was in the West Bank. I was in East Jerusalem. People who are living in grinding poverty want BDS. So that's simply not true. At the end of the day, I'm going to respect the broad-based sentiment. I believe it is a broad-based sentiment. And if this is a real problem, and if you're so concerned about it, what would you say about BDS that is targeted to corporations that profit from the occupation but that do not employ significant numbers of Palestinians? Would you support that? Couldn't we address your concern by tailoring BDS to those corporations?
I'm not sure that you can be that nuanced. I was in Ramallah and a city called Rarabi. I don't know if you've been to Rarabi. It's a brand new city being built. I was telling Mark about this before the meeting. Mm-hmm. This was 2 years ago, and I met. It's a beautiful city that the Palestinians are building. It's supposed to have eventually 50,000 people. And the head of the corporation that was building it said to me, their biggest problem is they can't, Israelis aren't allowed to supply them. So, and Israelis want to supply them with the infrastructure for the materials to build this city. So Israelis are also being deprived of the chance to invest in the Palestinian economy by their own government, by their own restrictions. What we need is a coming together, a convergence of right-thinking people who say we want to put this behind, we want to work together toward a solution that involves economic cooperation, and yes, eventually some kind of settlement that, I don't want to use the word settlement, something that will see some alignment of Palestinian aspirations, which are to live the kind of lives that Israelis want. They want good education for their kids, good health, a chance to get a good job. This, I suggest to you, is actually totally contradictory of that goal. And even though you may think that in principle it's the right thing to do, there was $250 billion of investment in Israel last year. The total investment in the Palestinian territories was something less than $4 billion. So Israel is not suffering. The Palestinians are suffering. And even though you may reject it, I say what you're doing is fighting this on the backs of Palestinians.
For those, I'll make a brief comment. I don't know who follows news in Israel-Palestine and the occupied Palestinian territories, closely reading publications like Ma'an or Electronic Intifada or other sources of information. You'll never hear about this or read about this in the Globe and Mail or the New York Times. You'll never hear about it on CBC Radio. But if you follow the news closely from sources that report on this, you know that not a single day or night goes by when doors aren't smashed down, people dragged out of their homes, homes ransacked, children arrested, dragged off to jails inside Israel proper, weekly peaceful demonstrations greeted with sound grenades, tear gas shots, skunk water, live ammunition, homes demolished. Since the beginning of 2016, I think something approaching 500 Palestinian homes have been demolished. I mean, if I were a Palestinian and I were living under this regime, I would be resisting. And I would imagine I'd be resisting peacefully, and I would be greeted with violence, because that's the way Israel treats peaceful resistance. So I respect your point of view. BDS is harming poor Palestinians. Maybe we should just let Israel employ them and give them good jobs. No. And I would also add that I think that a very explicit goal of the occupation, and it has been systematized, it's extremely sophisticated, and it's articulated, is to prove to the Palestinians every day and every night that they have nothing to do but to lower their neck beneath the jackboot, and to accept their fate, because they will never liberate themselves. And so humiliation is an explicit goal, systematic humiliation
and intimidation
to convince them that there is just nothing to be done except to submit. And under conditions such as that, I think it's insulting to say, why don't you just let the guys get good jobs from the Israelis? I'll leave it at that. Forgive me for abusing my the role of the chair.
I was next.
You go first.
Hi there. Sorry I'm late. I was just attending a Green Party of Manitoba policy committee meeting where we were not talking about BDS. It was much lighter topic. My name is Dirk Heppner, by the way. You may have seen me at the BGM this past August. It was my first BGM with the Green Party of Canada. It was fun, and it was also a bit hair pulling. I went into the BGM more or less a layperson supporter of BDS, and I'd say for the most part, as an individual, I still am. However, when it came down to the vote, I think it was on the Sunday, I ended up abstaining, as I thought that we weren't going forward with a really constructive policy. Subsequently, I see that there is a new policy on the table for the SGM in December, and I'll be there, and I'm sure you'll be there as well. So this is the consolidated and update Green Party policy on Israel and Palestine, and it's far too long for me to read all the whereases and be it resolves here. And this one is sponsored by Elizabeth May, amongst a large number of other people. And I'm certain that you've read it, and perhaps Dave, you may have read some of it as well too. And I don't know whether or not you've covered it here tonight at all, but would you like to share your thoughts on that, please?
So I don't know if you were present for this part of my presentation, but So I mentioned in my presentation that I was actually invited to co-sponsor that resolution. I declined to do so, principally because I don't think it goes far enough, but I've also agreed at the invitation of the Shadow Cabinet to participate in discussions in Vancouver at the end of the month about that resolution. And we've all more or less come to an understanding that that is a basis for a discussion, that resolution. And everybody is entering those discussions. Lisa Barrett, who was also removed from Shadow Cabinet, as was I, a strong supporter of the resolution, the BDS resolution, will be part of that discussion. We've all basically agreed that it's going to need to be changed in some respects. I'm not going to, you know, be shy in telling you what I think the problems with it are. I think it's a positive step. But at the end of the day, there's a real urgency to the needs of the Palestinian people. The United Nations predicts that if current trends continue, Gaza will be unlivable by 2020, in less than 4 years. Well, all the more reason why we need to act urgently. I wasn't aware of that. Thank you. I'm trying to answer this gentleman's question.
Yeah, I'll just addendum. I'm not disputing the need for.
I'm not trying to have disagreement. I'm trying to explain to you my position. So I come from the premise that there is a sense of urgency, and the only way to deal with the urgency is for there to be meaningful, peaceful sanctions imposed on the state of Israel. So there has to be, from my perspective, an unambiguous call for meaningful sanctions. That resolution doesn't do that. And I have specific ideas and suggestions that I'm going to make to members of Shadow Cabinet when I go to the meeting at the end of October, which I hope they will embrace. And if they do, there is a possibility, a distinct possibility of a compromise emerging, which doesn't amount to an endorsement of BDS. So I'm open to having that discussion.
And then there's another resolution.
Yeah, and maybe you could say something.
There is actually another resolution on the table in Calgary. It'll be the first one that's addressed. It's something that I wrote, and it actually calls for explicit sanctions to be imposed on Israel, because governments don't boycott and they don't divest, and political parties don't advocate boycotting and divestment. They engage in sanctions, and so this particular resolution actually lays out about a half dozen very explicit sanctions that should be imposed on the occupation.
Having done humanitarian and other work in Gaza Strip and the West Bank and Gaza, West Bank and East Jerusalem, the last 3 years, I think until you sit in a refugee camp or a children's center and watch the tear gas being shot into the playground for no particular reason at 2 o'clock in an afternoon, or you visit people in the hospital who have been arrested and tortured during the night by the IDF, or you see mothers crying because their sons have been taken away without charge and held indefinitely for months at a time, and they have no access to see them because of the prisons being in Israel and they needing to get through a checkpoint without permission. It's really unconscionable to say that the Palestinian people as a whole want are vengeful, because I spent years sitting in refugee camps in cities all over the West Bank, and I never once with various advocacy groups and peace groups never once heard a Palestinian say in any conversation that they wanted the destruction of Israel or they wanted and any harm done to Israelis. It was always about we need to figure out how we're going to live together. That was the conversation. And so if you haven't been there and sat there, don't label Palestinians as vengeful, because that's racism. The other thing I want to say is it's racism.
Okay.
The other thing I want to say, excuse me.
Can I just ask you, sir, to stand by and let this lady finish?
The other thing,
this person over here is
it's a dialogue. It's not just a question. The other thing that I wanted to say was, if you want facts on who fires rockets when, please go to the UN website, OCHA. They will tell you. Please check the UN website. They will tell you exactly how many invasions were made into camps and what happened every month. They'll give you a write-up. So if you want facts, go there. I think working together to end settlement construction in the West Bank is one place where many of us could meet on the same page here, it sounds like. If we could work towards that, I think that would be a start. And I've invited Israelis that I've met to accompany me into the West Bank. They're more than welcome to do so. And they would be welcomed, actually, and treated very hospitably. So if any of you would like to go on a trip, I'd take you inside the West Bank, and you would not be in any danger whatsoever. Thank you.
I think this lady's next, and then yourself, and then Rana.
I have to say that I'm not a supporter of the Green Party, and 3/4 of my children are half Jewish. So just a full disclosure. My name's Cheryl Ann Carr, and I have minor political and spiritual leadership in Aboriginal community here. And since you've been having, I came late. Unfortunately, I didn't hear all the great things that were said, and don't know all the arguments that were put forward. Though I do think I know a tiny little bit about Palestine. Though I don't have that as a personal experience, and have never been to Israel or Palestine, never been there, and don't know it firsthand, as all of you seem to. However, since the question and answer period, or the discussion period, started, I've been having a growing panic attack, an anxiety fit. Everything that's being said about the Palestinians has already been said about Native people. Every single thing, every argument that's come forward to say these people should shut up, sit down, get out of the way, and do what they're told has already been said to us. I would be very happy, well, I'm paraphrasing the way others paraphrased. I would be very happy to get on board with boycott, sanction, and diversity against the oppressors of the Aboriginal people in Canada. You know, when somebody starts that, I mean, there's been talks about it for the last couple hundred years. And when other countries stand behind us and boycott Canada until the rights of Native people in Canada happen, you know, I'm happy to get on that. I'd be one of the Native people that would absolutely vote. That's a good idea. But we've been quiet and waiting for good jobs and to not be incarcerated and to not have our children interfered with and to not have our health interfered with and to not be called rebels, terrorists, things over and over and over again for hundreds of years now. I think in my heart, I think that the Palestinian people should stand up straight and demand to be free and do what they think is absolutely in their best interests every time, in every place, everywhere they have to live, whether it's in their homeland, and it is their homeland. It can be a homeland for more than one people. It can be a homeland for more than one religion. It just boggles my mind, as I'm sure it does yours, panelists, how we can still have these elementary discussions instead of what's going to happen next for the freedom of all of us. I mean, for heaven's sakes, democracy everywhere and a right to be who the heck you are. Do you agree? That's my question.
I wanted to say that the Israelis withdrew from Gaza, and the situation is way worse in Gaza than it is in the West Bank. And, pardon me? It's not under siege.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Can I speak? Okay.
Yes. Yes. So, please continue. Yeah.
So the Palestinians elected a terrorist organization to lead them. So why is it Israel's problem about governing them? They are governed by a terrorist organization, Hamas. And they do not believe in the right of Israel to exist. In 1948, They were given the opportunity to have a two-state solution, which they voted against. Okay? So I am saying, and actually it's interesting about, you bring up First Nations. As Canadians, why wouldn't the Green Party be BDS exactly with First Nations, talking about Indigenous people to the land?
We do.
Really? Yeah. And so you given them the right to return to all the land that we stole from the natives?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
So, okay, go ahead and wrap up.
But anyway, so my point is, I think that, again, like Bernie said, that you're harming the Palestinian people and you're not helping the Palestinian people by boycott, divestment, and sanctions. And I believe that Israelis have tried to make peace, and it was rejected by Arafat because of law of return. And law of return?
Is if you are Jewish, you can go back.
Okay, I think Rana is next. Rana, I want you.
I am Palestinian. I'm not allowed to return. My parents had walked on feet in 1948, in 1967.
Because you were told that we would be thrown into the sea.
Why would we? 95% of the people were Muslims, like Muslims and Christians. 5% were Jewish people. We were Muslims, Christians, and Jewish living in one land. No problem to happen.
Right.
When my parents were born, there was no Israel. Suddenly, like, why would people just leave their land in fear, in horror, if they just, like, voluntarily? There are so many myths that need to be dispelled.
I do not.
Okay,
you know why, like, this is all happening? Because they bring the worst leaders, and they make them leaders that we do not choose, that we do not
pick. You did not choose the Hamas to represent you?
We do not.
The majority of Palestinians voted for a terrorist organization to rule over them.
A CD that you just repeat over and over and over, and that's all. Like, you have no argument.
This is difficult to have, like, three people talking simultaneously. No, that's okay, Rana. Would you like to just finish quickly wrap that up?
What partition plan? The partition plan 1947,
folks,
is it's not what you have taken. You have taken more. You are not interested in peace. If you really wanted peace, it would be a one-state solution for all the people living. This is not an equal party. This is an occupier and occupied people. We're not equal.
Okay,
it was occupied by Jordan before 1967. How come nothing was said about Jordan occupying?
I'm going to step in here.
I'm interested in what the Palestinian woman has to say.
This is challenging.
I'm interested.
This is extremely, this is something that everybody here in this room feels very deeply passionate about, and it's very exciting. And
this is an attack.
It's exciting and it's inspiring.
It's dehumanizing me.
Okay, sir.
Order!
Sir, if you have your say, you can probably have another say when you get to the mic. This lady here is going to say something, but Rana, do you want to quickly?
No,
if you want to go first, you may.
You're next.
Oh, okay. Well, I would like to say that as someone who is Jewish and grew up in an interfaith home, I haven't really come across anyone anti-Semitic per se, but faced minor little microaggressions here and there about little things like my dietary habits and my days of Sabbath, so on and so forth. I have never once experienced any of those microaggressions at the hands of any Arab Canadians or Palestinian Canadians. If anything, many of them whom I have met both here in Canada and when I was in the Middle East recently this spring have been very respectful and tolerant. And at the end of the day, when people criticize Israel, more often than not, I think we are criticizing the ideology behind its foundation, amongst other things, rather than the people who live there. Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Can we just let this gentleman say something, and then?
Sure. I just want to thank the organizers for having this evening, because it's such an important topic. There's a long way to go to make this a very much more of an important issue for millions and millions of Canadians. We have to convince the Liberal Party, we have to convince the Conservative Party, we have to really change, have fundamental change in this country to, in order to really achieve the goals of this movement. But it's really glad, I'm really glad to hear that there's a lot more organizations that are adopting these positions. The potential for building a real broad coalition in support of BDS is there. I think this is where we should really try to think about taking away what we learned tonight. I agree with the Green Party 100% on this issue. I wish you all the best in pursuing your aims within the party. I really want to see this kind of voice in Parliament as well. Thank you very much.
I'd just like to actually ask you a question.
Sure.
Sir, do you think that it's possible to admire the state of Israel even as a Jewish state, perhaps, and see much worth in the state of Israel, and for that precise reason, to support boycott, divestment, and sanctions on some level, perhaps nuanced, perhaps targeted, but to be generally in favor of placing a price on Israel for its occupation,
I think
precisely because one loves Israel?
If I think that it achieves, if it advances peace, I think I would be very much in favor. But I'm not convinced that it would advance peace. I think that UN Resolution 242 calls for a peaceful negotiations, and I don't think the BDS will promote the circumstance of negotiation. I think many Palestinians will look upon BDS as applying pressure where they don't have to go to the negotiating table. That's my concern. I think that there are other avenues, and I think we should subscribe to UN Resolution 242. We've attempted to make peaceful efforts at the negotiating table in Taba. We've also attempted to, I think it was Khartoum, Sudan, after the 67 war, similar arrangements were made, but I don't think the Palestinians at that time were interested, not the Palestinians, but the Arab countries were interested in peaceful negotiations.
Why should this
and
be
I think
a
the
matter
Olmer,
of,
yeah, the Olmer,
why should this be a matter of negotiations? If the settlements are illegal, grave breach of the Geneva Conventions, if the demolition of the homes of occupied people is a grave breach, if the arrest and forced transfer into Israeli jails is a grave breach, why should this be a matter of negotiations? Why shouldn't Israel simply be lovingly obliged and essentially forced to allow a state to be formed?
I agree that you should, that there shouldn't be expansion of the settlements, but under circumstances the other party is willing to recognize the security and sovereignty of the state of Israel. And unfortunately that hasn't been the case. And there have been multiple peaceful efforts attempted, but unfortunately in all circumstances the conciliatory party was Israel, and the other parties that was not making, not willing to make concessions. And again, I go back to the question that yet
moderator, can
answered,
we say something?
That like, has to do with human rights.
It's been 70 years we've been waiting, and now I'm in Canada, and I'm not going somewhere.
I want to go back to the other question, because the focus is so much on human rights, and how I don't think that there's much, I think that there's a lot of incongruity between perception and reality. I regard that Israel fares pretty well in terms of its record on the rule of law, subscribing to the rule of law, and also upholding human rights relative to other countries.
Thank you.
Under similar security concerns.
Thank you.
Can you name me another country, and I've asked this, and yet I haven't had a response from any of you. Can you name me a country that has a better record in terms of subscribing to the rule of law and maintaining human rights than Israel?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
You can't name me a country?
Thank you.
Okay.
You can't name me a country.
I take that as a rhetorical question.
it's not a common space, yet when you see space like this, you have other dominant views coming into such spaces. Thank you for all of you speaking. I just have a direct point to you. Since you've echoed a few times that you're trying to do a minimalist approach as a minimum basis, not a maximum quality, but a minimum basis, and you can see unreason and fear in the room that prevents such message from being echoed. So on a minimum level, you have people who are going to continue to be against your message, even though you're asking for a minimum. So don't you think that maybe a maximum approach might be better, since they're not listening anyways? And given that, maybe, I'm sorry, you might be a bit late, given that the BDS started 10 years ago, and sometimes even I try to not lose hope, but you could see, yeah. Palestinians have been described as knife-wielding. I have a child at home, and I hope you at least see me in that sense of a human. But my Christian father, who left in 1946 from the British Mandate of Palestine, and it's not about religion and being a Christian or a Muslim, but I'm throwing it in so that you don't label all Palestinians as one side. We can't go home to visit our family. When my grandfather died, whose name is George, George Bush wasn't famous then. So yeah, I come from a long Arab Christian family, and yet we've been kicked out from the same country that you still Christian Zionist myth that you still hold so dearly. So maybe
you said he left.
Maybe since you're in Canada now, maybe you could visit those reserves with a better sensitivity, that maybe when you go back, maybe you might see something different.
I would like
okay,
to
now,
say...
I'll give you 30 seconds, please. Stay,
okay.
Make it quick.
No, I was first. Okay? I would venture a guess, if the statistics are correct, that 1 in 10 people is gay, that everyone in this room would probably have a gay friend or a gay relative. And I would like to say that the Palestinians...
You're just pinkwashing now. I had a question to you. Would you prefer a maximal approach?
Do not believe in gay rights. Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. If you go onto the website, the Palestinian gay website, you will see many stories of Palestinians escaping to Israel to live a life of freedom and democracy.
Thank you very
topic.
Much.
This is an off topic. I wanted to thank you so much for today, and I wanted to tell you that Rehab Nazel is my friend. And if you remember the invisible exhibition, when the Israeli ambassador in Ottawa, when she had the permission in the city hall to have like her beautiful art, she was granted, she had a grant from the Ontario Art Council. She was like fought very, very fiercely, only just to expose some art, if this is like was so fearful. You remember the story, and you remember like how much they have attacked her, just for saying the truth. It's just the occupation. I wanted to say it's not an equal power. This is an occupied and occupier. We want to live in peace. We have lived in peace until we were stepped by their army boot on our necks, and we were expelled. Our people had to walk on feet, not once, twice. And then like when we go to inhospitable Arab countries, it's like not something I'm shy about, because we have left our home. It's again the same fate over and over and over.
But if you would have subscribed to the UN partition plan,
what partition plan? The partition plan was manufactured by Lisa Pearson. There's a Canadian connection to this. I am not going off topic.
Excuse me, please.
I wasn't born,
my friend. Rana, just finish, please.
You know, like when you have this kind of behavior and attack, and you are just trying to just voice like your concern as a human being, it's very difficult to talk. Like people coming here to sabotage and just like very destructive discussion. This is not how we're discussing this.
Why are you teaching your kids to be suicidal?
This is nonsense.
We're not.
Excuse me.
We are not suicide bombers.
Why don't you sit down?
What do you mean by suicide bombers? Become suicide bombers.
I've been Article 7 of the Thomas Charter states specifically, we will find every Jew, we will find every tree, under every stone, and we will kill them.
You will not kill them. You
that's what we are on the 7 of the Thomas Charter.
You want your arms. Your idea of arms. You will know this. I was 14 when I was there. Let's put the arms of the country.
I was going to be asking.
You.
This is are you disrupting exactly the session? Exactly. Sit down. Sit down and listen or leave. Sit down and listen or leave.
Sure.
You cannot keep attacking people. That's not the way to discuss. We are coming here to learn and to hear.
I was going to actually ask at the very beginning. For everybody in this room to be a peacekeeper, for everybody in this room to act like they love peace.
May I just say a few words before you go?
Rhonda,
I'd like to say a couple of things before you go.
Thank you very much. We appreciate people who are our support. I am a vice president of the CPAM organization. Palestinian organization here. We have 500 members. We are existing. Our support to you.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm here as an observer. My background would be German. I'm a Mennonite. Both sides of my family lived in the Ukraine. It's interesting. There's a blue bedspread in our closet that has been there all my life. It came from my grandmother, and my mother's family worked. There were Germans working on collective farms in the Ukraine, a dangerous situation for all concerned. And this blue blanket came from a Jewish home that had been abandoned. And of course, at the end of the war, things were desperate. You needed everything, and I've always. Every now and then I've looked at this thing in the closet because it ties so many things together in my life. My mother had to change her name when she entered Germany because it was still Nazi Germany, and her name was biblical, so it was considered to be Jewish. And on it went. She got there in time for the saturation bombing of Dresden. The 19th century was just a disgusting hellhole all around. And we're all war damage. And we're all broken. How can we expect to have a functioning society when I, as a child, being German, 7 years old, going to school, the first thing I felt shame about was being German. And now I know, because we were all blooming fascists, and we still have those roots in us. Only one place had to acknowledge it, and I'm not saying it shouldn't have. That's not what I'm about. I'm gay. I know what systemic harm does. I know what it does here in Canada. And I do not salute the Canadian brand. That flag was shoved in my hand with a racist song in 1967 while genocide was active policy. So all of this stuff, and you know what? The thread is just, I could sew this together into a giant ball. But I think there needs to be a personal accounting from everyone, especially when there's harm being done. And it needs to not be just simply always ignored and justified. Justifications ring really hollow really quick when violence is happening. And they are long gone with Israel and with everything wrapped around it. And I'm upset actually that queer was dragged in. Do not use my shitty experience here as a reason to support Israel, because these rights aren't so great here, and they're meaningless there in the context of the greater harm being done. And so these are complex things, but I can tell you I am racist and I am sexist, and because I grew up in a white supremacist racist soup here in Canada. And I resent it, and it makes me angry, and I hear it replicated in every level here. Let's deal with the war damage now. Let's get over this. But you know what? Listening to, while corporations are making massive amounts of money, and my retirement, my ability to eat, depends, and have a roof over my head as I'm old, maturing ahead of my time for various reasons, that I have to invest in shitty companies like Monsanto and who knows what kind of mining company and also what kind of weapons company. And that's just to eat. So we've all been wrapped into this against our will. And so I'm tired of being put in all these boxes. My whiteness and my maleness have made me blind for my whole life. And I've had enough of that. And it's time to move on from all these things. The behavior here was terrible. And I think when people are suffering, you have to acknowledge that. And if you don't, then it's just another example of the oppressed becoming a greater oppressor. And that's where I stand.
We're going to try to wrap up fairly soon because we have to be out of here by 10. But please.
I wanted to say he reminded me that most people are against the Holocaust, which once occurred. Not because we hate the Germans, but because we didn't like what was done. Perhaps when we were too young or not even born then. But it is not because we are anti-German that we decry the Holocaust. And in the same way, we don't have to be anti-Semitic to decry what is going on today in Israel. I wasn't born in those days of the Holocaust, but this is going on today, and I'm living today, and I want to do something about it, which doesn't make me anti-Semitic any more than I'm anti-German.
Thank you. You can support BDS. It won't be. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I just want to piggyback on that and say it's really about being against Israeli state policy. It has nothing to do with being anti-Israeli or anti-Jewish. It's about the policies of the state of Israel that is the problem. And arguing from a human rights international law perspective, I think, is a really, it's a solid foundation, and that's the conversation. It's policies of a state, and absolutely our state is implicit in, well, in a lot of things that we continually need to hold ourselves and our government accountable to. So I appreciated what you all said too.
So, hello. So I'm staff here at the church. I'm here not because I actually knew this was a thing happening. Because I work here and I was asked to be staff for this event, and I'm very glad that I was staff for this event because this was a very great thing for me to be at, even if it got really, really heated at a number of instances. Because it's really important to talk about. I had a bunch of stuff. I'm trying to remember it. I'm so sorry.
Very badly for Rana and her partners, Rafi and Rana. I feel very badly for them because they were driven out. They were bullied out of this room.
Mm-hmm.
That was awful.
Mm-hmm. It is very awful. Unfortunately, this is such a touchy, sensitive issue, and I personally am in full support of BDS. And I fully support the rights of Palestinians to free themselves from their oppression. And it's so unfortunate that this issue gets just so sensitive and it gets so heated, even when you bring up the facts and the figures, and then you have people just ignore it and have all this awful rhetoric they spout. And really, I admire you coming out and doing this. And this is your seventh, you said, Jonathan? I can't imagine how much crap like this you probably had to see. This is the seventh one, apparently.
Yes, this was by far the most difficult one.
Ooh. Welcome to Winnipeg.
Thank you very much. Is there anything else you wanted to say?
No, but thank you very much for coming out here, and I'm glad that I was here today.
I do want to say one thing, though. I want to have one closing thought, which to me was the most telling. I'm very sorry that this disintegrated in the way it did. It nonetheless, I think, was a very important and educational experience for all of us, including me.
And to me, the most telling moment of the evening was when the gentleman came up and he asked me about the unemployment rate in Palestine, and he challenged me on the damage being done to the Palestinian people, and he read a statement from some unknown Palestinian which condemned those who support BDS because of the effect it's having on Palestinian workers. And yet the moment a Palestinian, a live, breathing Palestinian in the room, stood up to speak and to express support for BDS, her partner were bullied out of the room. We had them here to speak and tell us how they felt. Their voices didn't matter, but the voice of somebody on paper who happened to be consistent with the view being expressed by that gentleman, that did matter. And ultimately, what I've learned from this whole experience, and it's a very painful realization that I've come to, because it's not one that simply applies to my country, but it regrettably applies to my party to some degree. It's very painful, and that is that even within our party, we don't attach the same value, some of us, to Palestinian life as we do to other life. Palestinian lives matter every bit as much as Jewish lives, Christian lives, atheist lives, all lives. And I regret to say that we have to go through a process in our party of coming to realize that. Many of us do, many of us understand that and we embrace it fully, but some of us don't. And that's the challenge that I and others who support this resolution confront.